Hello, warm welcome. You're here. You're here, yeah? And we're so grateful to be with you, yeah? We've been imagining you as we've been preparing, and wow, it's even better than we imagined. Yeah. So I'm feeling particularly grateful that we can gather like this across, you know, we're around this beautiful round earth that we each inhabit in our particular place, and we're able to be connected here. It's fantastic. So I just want to give you a warm welcome, and I wonder if you could also just feel like what it would be like to welcome yourself. Yeah, and also hold each other. Just for a moment, let's welcome ourselves. So just imagining here, warming my palms together. You might want to join me, just rubbing your hands together, just feeling like, oh yeah, here I am. As you rub your palms together, you might imagine like in that warmth that might start to emerge, also a feeling warmth, not only a temperature warmth, but yeah, like a loving kind of kindness warmth. Yeah, you might feel the backs of the hands too. I'm a rock climber, so I feel like, oh, I feel like I want to squeeze my hands. That feels good. My hands get used to a lot. Yeah, I'm going to take all that good energy. Imagine it, the hands all charged with love and care, and just invite you to place them on your body somewhere that feels good. I typically like to find the heart and the belly. Just imagine welcoming yourself, yeah, welcoming yourself to a retreat space, to a space that's intentionally being set for safety, dignity, belonging, welcoming yourself into safety, dignity, belonging. So what are you maybe wanting the space for yourself? Just being a yes to yourself. We can have a sense of being here in community. So letting that curiosity and warm welcome just extend to the whole circle here. Yeah, this whole circle around our world. So if you like, you can scroll through some images and just see that we're here with many people. Actually, can we just go on gallery view for a second? Just so we can take me off spotlight. Take me, Viveka, one of your retreat leaders, off spotlight. And just, can we just have a gallery view and just, yeah, let's just take a look. Give yourself a chance to see who's here. Some of you may find every face here fresh. A funny confession, I'm in a different time zone than Balajit and Singhashri. And I was happily sleeping here in California. So Viveka, she, they pronouns, happily sleeping in California while they were in a meeting they thought I was going to be at. So they had no idea where I was. And when I finally got on, thinking it was the meeting time in my time zone, they were so happy to see me. It was really like I got on and I had this response from people that were like, "We're so glad to see you." I was like, wow, that's amazing. Most people aren't that happy to see me. It's because they were wondering whether I was going to make the retreat or not. So we can just be that happy to see each other. So for some of you, it might be like, wow, there's a lot of folks that maybe I haven't met before. That's true for me. And then we may also, maybe there's a face or two or many that look familiar to you. So it's all good. We all imagine everybody here deeply belongs. Yeah. All right. So again, we want to welcome you to the retreat. One thing we want to say is that we're recording the session. Yeah, because we have our retreat cousins other members of this community who, like me, maybe were sleeping just recently or still are, because we have people from across many time zones. So we will be recording, and we'll be recording only in a gallery review, or when gallery view, like we just had, which was many, many folks. You know, there's something like 170 people who have registered, and, you know, different numbers of people will be here at different times. So if we go back to that welcome slide, there we are. So if you do not want to be recorded, you can always just turn off your camera. And in general, it would be the gallery view that's recorded, or the retreat leaders who are spotlighted, you know, folks that are, and anyone that maybe comes on to spotlight. But you'll be in choice about that. And you can always turn your camera off. And in general, you know, you're invited to have your camera on or off. So, you know, I notice that in a way, having our camera on is one way we can extend our energy into the world. So when we're in relationship in the world, you know, sometimes we are more aware of receiving that sense of being in the world, and sometimes we're more actively extending ourselves into the world. So the camera is one form of extension. And, you know, your camera is welcome. I want to say that especially because we're online, that sometimes that camera, that way of extending ourselves through a camera, can really be a gift. But also, you need to balance the gift to yourself of what you need. Yeah. Sometimes we aren't feeling well, or it just feels like a lot just to be on camera, and that is all welcome. Yeah. So please, invitation to extend, and an invitation also to rest with the camera view. Rest and turn the camera off. So, hey, you signed up to a retreat, Forces for Good. So we are also co-conspiring. We're gathering together to be a force for good in our world. Yeah. And I believe our world needs that. So I also believe that it matters. However, you're able to participate in this retreat that's going to be running, you can imagine a space, a portal that's opened up in our world as a force of good. It's going to be running for the next week. And you get to add your energy to that. And we also get to see and learn how that is going to take form. Yeah. So we do have a structure, and while we're together today, this first session, we're going to help us all just tune into each other, tune into what's happening, the structure of the retreat, a little bit about the theme. And you'll notice that whatever we do, we're really wanting to help us, each one of us, and help ourselves come home to the body as a powerful place of awakening, of energy, of wisdom, of compassion. Yeah. So throughout, we're going to just be building in ways to connect with our embodiment. Yeah. So I believe that because we're on this amazing technology that lets us connect and be on retreat from wherever you are, that does not equate to having to be disembodied, you know. And so actually, we want to be together in this amazing format. Have you be really deeply grounded in place, you know, starting with the place of the earth that you're touching, the home of the body, and then this place that we're creating with each other, which is a place of warm welcome, this place of safety, dignity, and belonging for each of us, for all of us, to explore this theme of emotions as forces for good. Yeah. One thing we want to do is just have us actually connect. So it can be a lot, just having a lot of folks come on to a space. I mean, we can imagine what's happening is there's right now, there are 76 of us. And it's like, oh, we just walked into a space, or we just came into a space, you know, however our mobility is. Maybe we used a wheelchair to come into a space, and there are 76 folks, or maybe, you know, you're in a condition where you need to be in bed, and 76 folks, like this amazing Mahayana Sutra, the Vimalakirti Nirdesha, this sutra, this Buddhist story, where all these people show up in this person's bedroom because they're bedbound. Yeah. So here we are, 76 of us together. So we want to just have you be able to turn and connect with a smaller grouping, just to say hi. So we're going to make groups of four. And the prompt for that is for you to share your name. Whereas there's an invitation to use pronouns, so I'll say why. Why we do that is to create welcoming. So you'll be noticing I'm on a theme of welcoming. You know, I am descended from Chinese immigrants. So in a way, my family came here not knowing, came to the United States not knowing anything about what it would be like to live here, you know, having to learn it all as they came. And they really relied on creating welcoming being created for them. Yeah. And still, you know, it matters when, you know, still at this time, with the time of heightened polarization in our world and in the US context, there's a lot of another round of polarization around whether Asian immigrants actually belong. Yeah. So there's just signals of when someone actually is friendly to me, it just actually means a lot. It helps me relax. It helps me know I'm welcome. So pronouns are a way we let each other know that however you identify in your gender, you are welcome. And we assume that we assume there's a wonderful difference, that we're not all just one way here. And we make space for that. Yeah. So for some of us, that might be really meaningful. So it's just another way we can extend. It's a way to extend. And we're not forcing anyone to do this. It's really an invitation to try it on and practice, because it could matter really quite deeply to somebody. So pronouns by that, there's an example, he, she, they, there's some other pronouns. Some people don't use pronouns and they just say, you can call me by my name. So whatever it is for you, and where you call home. So just to model this and to show you who's helping hold the space, we're gonna ask, first, our folks holding technology from the Buddhist Center Online to introduce themselves using these prompts, welcoming you in.
I'll go first. I'm Stephen, he, him pronouns, and I'm joining from Manchester.
Hello, everyone. Nice meeting you here. I am Dayaketu. I am part of Dharma Chakra team here at the Buddhist Center Online. My pronouns are he and him. And I'm here tuning in from Mexico City. So very nice seeing you here.
Hi, everyone. Yeah, I'm Zach. He, him. And I've already forgotten what I was supposed to do.
Where do you call home?
Where do I call home? I'm in the Nottingham Buddhist Center. I'm in a community above the Nottingham Buddhist Center. So yeah, very nice to see so many of you. Good.
Yeah. Deep. I wonder if we can have like send these people some love, because they have been pushing buttons and making things work. <It's amazing. laughs> Thank you. However, we can send you some love. And then the team that's teaching. So I've already introduced myself. And we've got, hello.
Hi, everybody. Oh, it's so good to see so many familiar faces, and also just as wonderful to see new faces. So welcome. So I'm Singhashri, she, her, or they, them pronouns. And I'm zooming in from where I call home, which is Muswell Hill in London, the UK, planet Earth. Over to you, Balajit.
Great, thank you. Yeah, really nice. To see you all and the odd pussycat. My name's Balaji. I'm he, him, and I'm currently living in Birmingham, UK. Yeah.
Great to see you. Or it's just channel the love I got this morning. It's so good to see you. Okay. So we have a slide with the prompts. We can also put them in chat, but you're just going to do just what we did. Yeah. They're in chat, name, pronouns, where you call home. So we're going to be in groups of four-ish. And Zach, just checking that we can make, I texted someone else by mistake. Can we make the breakouts 8 minutes? Is that possible? The timing?
Yeah.
Great. All right. So we'll see you in 8 minutes. You'll have a minute or two each, and just make sure everyone gets to share. Enjoy. I'm glad we all got to connect with a few other folks. And as the retreat goes, there'll be some other opportunities for that. So if you would like to, it's helpful sometimes if you're able to do this, to change the way you're named at the bottom of your screen. You'll see on my screen, to add your name, your pronouns, and where you're zooming in from. I'll just say that I include a land acknowledgement. So in the United States, due to our history, another way we create welcoming is actually acknowledging that the land we're on comes from a history of the displacement of the native peoples of the United States. So in my naming of myself, I include as a remembrance, as a mindfulness practice, the land that I'm on. So I want to acknowledge the Ohlone land, the Ohlone people. And I know our cousins here coming from New Zealand, for example, I know that there's a very strong practice of this kind of thing in some parts of the world, just as we recognize our context and history. So you can add your name, your pronouns, and where you're zooming in from by, if you hover over, your screen, there should be in the upper right-hand corner, I believe, three dots, and just in your little square. And there's an option to rename yourself there. If anyone else has another way to do that, that sometimes helps people, I welcome your voice to come in from the Buddhist Center online team. But that's the way I do it. I go to the right-hand corner, hover over the three dots. Yeah, Dayake too?
Yeah, another option is if you go into the participants list and then find your name and then click more and then rename yourself. That's another option.
Great. So that participant list is at the bottom bar. Of tools. Thanks. All right. So over to Balajit for our theme, exploration of our theme. What is emotion and why is it important in our current context? I'm going to leave the spotlight.
Yeah. Thank you, Viveka. Yeah. So I printed off a little table, a wheel earlier. As I was thinking about emotions, and there's been various attempts to map the human emotions, and this is one of them. So we are, as beings, quite complex emotionally, and just looking at this chart just today, you know, I've been noticing how I've been moving around different points of the chart, and also, like, you know, sometimes experiencing a few of them together at once, you know, And I think, one thing for me is, if I look at my own life, it's an ongoing process, this, but it's just made such a difference for me, changing how I relate to different emotions that come into my experience, you know. Changing how I relate to different emotions that come into my experience. So it feels like there's just so much at stake, you know, in terms of how we are as humans with the inevitable range of emotions that arises in our experience, you know. Do I habitually fight against? Do I try and ignore? What are my kind of patterns? And what's it like to just get curious? You know, what's it like to just get curious and to try to come into a more welcoming relationship even? And what kind of, what can help me in my life stay connected with myself, you know? So, one of the things for me is something around you know it feels very human to want to experience joy, to want to experience fulfillment, to want to connect with myself and connect with other people and the world, you know. And but one thing for me is that I noticed that if I close down against difficult emotions, I also close down against the possibility of living more in the heart, really, because the heart for me has is kept closed by feelings I can't cope with. You know, when I can't cope with a feeling, I tend to get anxious, I tend to kind of get dissociated, I tend to feel kind of flat. So there's something for me around there's so much to be gained from developing resilience, to staying open to myself and learning what supports me to sort of do that, really. And the phrase I've come up with recently is that it's like the difficult emotions are like the runway into the heart, you know, and that seems to be our deepest longing, you know, to live from the qualities of the heart. So that's just sort of what comes to mind just in a few minutes. So I'll pass on to one of my colleagues, Viveka or Singhashri.
I'm happy to say something. Can you all hear me okay? Yeah, okay. Yeah, thanks, Balajit. It's good to hear that from you. I'm just tuning in just now to how I'm feeling, what's happening in the emotional landscape. And I'm noticing a lot of sort of bubbling energy coming up from the belly and filling the whole area around the heart center, which I tend to identify as a kind of excitement. And there's a little bit of nervousness mixed in there as well. And I'm also aware of quite a lot of warmth in the heart, which I tend to associate with gratitude. So I'm just really feeling so much gratitude for all of you, you know, hearing the call for this retreat and answering it and coming along and wanting to be in this space with us, exploring this theme that's so important for us individually, for us as a movement, practitioners on our spiritual journeys alongside each other and our world that is hurting so much and is desperately calling out for healing and transformation. So yeah, so feel that those are the emotions I'm noticing just now. And just as you were speaking, Balajit, I was remembering being in Northern California in January and spending quite a lot of time with Viveka. We got more time together than we had planned on, which was a lovely surprise. And one of those days I went to visit someone that Viveka and I both know, a wonderful woman named Margarita Loñez, who's become a good friend of mine. And when she talks about the body, she talks about it, she uses two descriptions that I just love and really help me to connect with the emotional body. So she talks about our bodies being like organs of perception or instruments of feeling. And when I say those words out loud, what I tune into is this sense that the emotional world, all of these, you know, that chart that you just held up, Balajit, you know, this whole range, some quite subtle, some probably sometimes quite strong, and everything in between, it's like the language of the body. It's like the body. Like if the language of the mind is thoughts, then the language of the body is the emotions. And how can we learn to really get fluent in that language? Learn to listen deeply to the messages there and also learn to engage with, you know, to lean into and engage creatively with what there might be there to discover about ourselves and how we are showing up with each other and with the and in the world. And yeah, there's something for me also about learning to have a lot of patience. So I had a, Balajit and I were recently on residential retreat together, and my intention was to really trust in slowing down and really trusting in the time that it takes for emotions to really reveal themselves and the fullness of their messages. So I will stop there. I think I've probably been speaking for longer than my allotted time. I'm going to pass to Viveka. Thanks for listening.
You're speaking exactly in the time of your emotions, the pace of your emotions, Singhashri. So again, Viveka. I was thinking a story about really this brings up why I first was seeking out the Dharma and specifically meditation. So when I was in my, I think I probably wasn't even 20 years old yet, I could feel that those, let's say 18 or 19 years of life, plus the lineage behind me, you know, the lineage of human history and my family's history within that, you know, all that coming felt by me, the deep context I was in, I could feel that already at the tender age of 18 or 19, there was a lot of armoring around my heart. I mean, I didn't know that much then. I knew a lot, but I certainly knew that. I could feel it. And it was a bit like a cage. You know, there was like a world out there and a world in here. And it just felt kind of sad to have an armoring around the heart. So when I was pursuing Buddhism, it was the same time that I was also training in science in university. And I felt like, well, there is a science of how the material world works. But I could tell that I would continue to develop this kind of split if I didn't also look at, let's say, what is important to understand the science of the heart and why was this heart behind a wall? Yeah. So that's at the same time that I was learning all about quantum physics, and atoms and whatever else, you know, moving at the speed of light. I was also slowing down and making the deep inner journey to understand the heart. And over time, I've been pleased to discover that actually what my heart needs and what is around my heart now is something more like this very emotionally intelligent, responsive, alive, dynamic, rainbow light kind of, I call it a plasma because it has some, I can feel it, it's got some texture. But it's certainly not a wall. It's a form of energetic exchange that can let in and let out. Yeah. So that's kind of image or story of a journey from a wall to something that actually connects, and in that allows me space to connect both inwardly, like to understand the language of what it's like to be in deep. I am in a relationship with the entire world, and that can be a lot. You know, I'm in relationship with the farthest cosmic dust and the neighbor next door that was just using a leaf blower. it's all there, yeah, simultaneously. Wow. And this kind of intelligent awareness, this rainbow light plasma, let me call it, or just this emotional awareness and curiosity, it helps with just what is that language, that exchange of being so deeply embedded in our world? And that is, in a way, is all I am. All I am is relationship. So the longer I've practiced and studied Buddhism, I've come to really find that what's important is in all the nature of reality teachings and all the wisdom teachings, that maybe the most important reality is that all there is relationship. Yeah, it's another way of talking about how we exist. We are relational, and therefore emotions are so important. And I'll say that under pressure of all that might be happening internally and externally, what can happen is we can harden, right? That armor, even by 18 or 19, there can be quite a lot of armor, yeah? So all through our life, we can be hardening against that experience, or we can be through practice. And I believe that Buddhism is really encouraging us to experience, to wake up to the experience in a supported way. And so that we can be awake to the reality of our being in relationship. And so we have a chance to also soften, but with wisdom, you know, like to soften in the sense of being willing to experience, being willing to experience what it's like to be human, not just over here in this body. You know, what's it like to be just alive? What's it like to be human in another body, but also in our world, right? The very important body of our world, the body of the earth, the body of the trees, the body of other living beings. So I think that's why it matters, that if we are awake and awakening and learning how we can experience more fully, I also believe that comes with actually being able to extend love and non-harm, our first precept of Buddhism, into the world. I think it's from there really that we can practice that authentically. Thanks. So I think we're going to, in the journey of the spotlight, moving around, the light of love is coming over to Balajit. Is that right? Yes.
I'll happily take the light of love. Good. So we're going to do a little lead practice now, just for about several minutes. Find yourself somewhere reasonably comfortable. I'm going to lead us in a grounding practice. Maybe just checking that your belly can freely breathe here, that it's not restricted by a tight belt or clothing, buttons and such. And it can be quite tempting at the start of a meditative period to almost willfully force calmness, like imposing on the body an agenda. So the invitation here, just as we sit together, see if you can just open to house the felt sense of your being here now, just as it's presenting. So just receiving your experience now. And as you sit here, you may get some sense of what we label breathing, the movement of the body with the breath. So it's a gentle orientation of attention to the felt life of our body as we practice together. We come into relationship potentially here with a cloud of sensations. The sensations of being alive. So feeling your life. Feeling your aliveness. This shimmering arising of sensations, tingling, pulsing currents, coolness, warmth, pressure. Any tension, ease. We can have a strong karmic momentum into thinking, just noticing if there's the strength of thought worlds comes in and disconnects you from the body. And there can be the force of vagueness as well. Gently just seeing if you can open back to the energy of your being, which may include numbness and a lack of sensation. So this isn't allowing the body to be just as it is. This feels a bit too much. You like, might like to open your eyes, look around, or pay attention to sounds, something external. And as we sense the body, the invitation now is to feel the contact of your being with what's supporting you. The chair or the bed or the floor, and feel how the earth element is holding us here, how what's supporting us is holding us here. And that contact is rich in sensations, energetic. As we feel that contact with the support beneath us, we may be able to open to the qualities of the support beneath us, connected to the ground. There's a stillness. A stability. Ground is offering its peace and stillness to our being. So we're opening to the felt life of our being, emotion, energy, sensation. And we're opening to this plane of stillness that we sit on or lie on. Body ground. Body ground. Body ground. So in a minute, I'll ring the bell and we'll come to the end of this period of practice.
Thank you, Balajit. That's lovely. Great invitation to connect and slow down. Even my computer, whose fan has been going crazy, has decided to finally calm down. So so there was a question in the chat earlier about the shape of today and when we were going to have a break. So just want to say we are going to break in just a few minutes. And before then, I thought I would just say a bit more about the shape of the retreat and of today and a few things around that. So just bear with me while I share my screen. Okay, so here we are. We have arrived on the retreat. So firstly, just want to make sure we're all clear about times as best we can be. So you got to know where you are. So hopefully you all know where you are in the world. For some reason, this slideshow is on a timer. So apologies for that. So just have a look and just find your location and your timings. So what we're calling the first session is a 2-hour session, and the times are there for all the different locations. So this is every day starting from tomorrow. We'll have 3 sessions, a first session, a middle session, and a late session. And the middle session is also 2 hours, and then the late session is 1.5 hours. And actually, while we're talking about time, I also just want to do a special shout out to people who I think have gotten up in the middle of the night to be with us for this first session, because I did notice there were a few of you here. So thank you for being here. That's real commitment. So there's your times. And I'm going to say a little bit about this later as well, but there are going to be online resources where you can find all sorts of things around the retreat. So I will put this PowerPoint up as well on the online resources, so you have that. And then in terms of what's happening, so we want to recognize that for many of us, an at-home retreat means that there's other things that we might have to attend to while we're on retreat. So we want to be really, we really, really want to extend to you to not feel like if you're not able to make it to a session that you're missing anything. And one thing that will help with that is that we're recording all the sessions, and the recordings, the Dharma Chakra team is going to be working really hard to get those recordings up as soon as possible after each session. So they think probably within 2 to 3 hours after each session. So if something's going on while you're sleeping, it'll be there for you when you wake up. Or if something's going on while you've been at work, it'll be there for you when you get home. And the retreat has a momentum and an energy of its own. So we've already created something by coming together today on this first session and beginning this journey. And so if someone's not technically on the Zoom screen, that doesn't mean that they're not with us. They're just not able to join that session. And we just trust that everyone's doing the best they can to make the retreat work for you in the context of your life. So please don't worry if you can't be here for everything. It would be a stretch for everyone to be here for everything, given where we are all located in the world. So yeah, wanted to just really make that very clear. So in the first session, that first 2 hour block, mostly what will be happening is there'll be some short teacher input. There'll be some guided meditations and some inquiry, which is a chance for us to just get curious together about what you're noticing in your direct experience. And Balajit and I will be holding that session. Viveka would love to be there, and it's probably like midnight for her. So that would be a stretch, that she'll be catching up on the recordings. And then the middle session, there'll be a bit of a longer stretch of teacher input. We're assuming that this time is the time that most people can make. So that's when we've decided to do the most of in terms of our input. We'll be doing some group exercises. We'll also be guiding some meditations during that time. And then there'll also be a chance for small group sharing. And just to say, in that middle section, we've built in this time for what we're calling metabolizing. So it's like digesting all the wonderful things we'll be throwing at you. So that's the small groups, is the metabolizing time, where you're able to just sort of chew things over with four or five other folks. And those groups are going to be different every day, but it's always going to happen at the same time. So it's always in the second half of the middle session. So that's a consistent theme throughout, or block of activity throughout the retreat. And then the late session is going to be, is going to include more meditation, some movement. We'll be bringing in what's called resourcing. Those are different short practices we can do to support the nervous system, to just arrive more fully, to support presence, to support regulation. And then chanting and ritual, which are also forms of resourcing, different ways of bringing in sound and devotional practice. So that's the overall shape. And just to say, if you've got any questions, because we are assuming that there probably will be questions around all this, so do feel free to drop those in the chat and we'll take a look at them during the break and then address them when we get back from the break. So today, we're about to have a break. It'll be 15 minutes. We'll address any questions when we get back. And then we're going to do activity around the question of what supports safety and belonging. And that'll include a led reflection, some small group sharing, and then we'll introduce what we're calling community agreements, which are ways that we can be together in community in a way that works for us and supports, in a way that helps us to feel safe enough in the group, and therefore can support going deeply, connecting deeply, and going deeply into our own experience. And then we'll have an hour and a half break, and then we'll come back for the late session. We'll do a harvesting of our community agreements. I love that word. I had never heard that until yesterday when Viveka brought it in. So it's an opportunity to harvest from your small groups any fruits of your small group discussions and bring that into the community agreements. And then we'll do some awakening of the chakras and guided meditation. So that's the shape of the rest of today. And then just to say about small groups, so I already mentioned this, we'll be in small groups for the last half of the middle section. And the Dharma Chakra team is going to be working hard to make sure that those groups have enough people in them to make them meaningful. So if you'd prefer not to go into small groups, that's absolutely fine. We're totally happy for people to stay in the main room and reflect on your own. But please, please, if you could let the team know by private chatting them, that you'd prefer to stay out of a group. And what that means is they'll keep you out of a group, but that all the groups will still have the right number of people in them. If you don't private chat them, the risk is that someone might end up in a room on their own, and we'd really like to avoid that because that doesn't feel very good. So yeah, please do let them know, and let them know with enough time so they can make sure to be able to meet your request. And then the main room will stay open. We'll have some quiet music playing for anyone who'd rather just reflect on their own. Okay, so I'm going to stop talking now And let's go ahead and have our break. And again, if you have any questions about the shape of the retreat or what's happening today, or small groups or anything else that I just talked about, do feel free to drop that in the chat and we'll address those after the break. So it's, go on, Viveka.
No, I'm just asking you, how long is our break?
Yeah, so it's 15 minutes. So it's 7 past the hour in the UK. So we'll come back at 22 minutes past the hour, to be precise. So enjoy your break and we'll see you in a little bit. Thanks, everybody. So welcome back, everybody. I'm just looking through the chat and noticed there's no questions, which is fantastic. And if you do have questions, they're completely welcome. So please do feel free to drop any questions in the chat about the retreat, how it works, how you can engage with it as we get going into this next section, or at any time over the next hour. And, you know, we're just getting going here. We're just in the arriving phase. So really happy to sort all that out between this, the end of this session and the whole of the next session. And I did forget one thing, which is the resources. So I just want to ask our tech team if they could put the links to the event page on the Buddhist Center Online. So there'll be a page where you can find the recordings for the sessions and other resources. And there's also this wonderful tool called Padlet. And already, even though we haven't gone over them yet, the community agreements are there. So this is for this next section. And we'll just keep adding resources. If someone offered to put the motion wheel up there, you might have other resources, poems, music, websites that relate to the topics that we're exploring. And that's an open space for all of us to share our inspiration and the things that we're that come to mind as we get into this material together. So please do use those resources. So yeah, so for the next little while, we're going to get into this question around what supports safety and belonging, particularly and especially in the context of an online retreat, and what we're hoping to get out of this retreat for ourselves and each other. So we'll start by just doing a little bit of a reflection, and I'll guide us in this. And you can feel free to take notes during the reflection. You can have your eyes open or closed, be in whatever posture feels comfortable to you. So you don't have to be in any special way, just whatever supports you to drop into what I'll be offering here. And if it's comfortable, maybe taking a few deeper breaths, doing some self-touch, like Viveka invited earlier, just to come back into presence, connection with yourself. So yeah, there's an invitation just now to just call to mind a time in your life when you felt like you were safe enough. And it may be that was in a group of other people, either online or in person. Or maybe it was with animals or with nature or a combination of those things. So just a time in your life when you felt safe enough. Where your needs were met. You felt in connection with yourself and others, able to show up fully, share openly. And just allowing yourself to notice what comes up in response even to the question, thoughts, emotions, sensations. This invitation to bring to mind this time when you felt safe enough. And then I want to invite you to also just reflect on what the conditions were that supported that sense of safety So what were the conditions that supported you to feel safe enough? Maybe it had something to do with the environment you were in or the people you were with, the things they were saying and how they were saying them, things they were doing and how they were doing them. What were the conditions that supported you to feel safe enough? Just really trusting in whatever emerges here. It may not be clear thinking, it might just be a sensation or an image or a feeling, an emotion. So we don't have to have words for everything necessarily. So yeah, do take a minute to just jot anything down if that's your learning style and it helps to take some notes or draw a little picture. Also feel free to move in any way that feels supportive, move, touch, rub, caress, squeeze. And so we're gonna go into groups of five to share around what the conditions are that support a sense of safety. But before we do that, I just want to say a couple of things. So we're going into these groups in a way as the first step in exploring our community agreements around how we can be together in this sacred space, exploring this tender material. So we don't have those agreements yet in place. So I just want to name a couple of ways just that we can hold space in these smaller groups as we get going with this. So one thing is one of my favorite agreements, which is the right to pass. So you might end up in a group, and then as you're hearing other people sharing, you actually feel that you don't really want to say anything, and that's fine. So you always have a right to not, you don't have to contribute. There's no expectation of that. And we can also just be there, be present to each other, take each other in, receive one another's sharings. So the right to pass. And then another one is mindful listening. So just noticing as we listen to others, if you're doing what I often do, which is start rehearsing in your own mind what you're going to say, which is kind of, it's natural, isn't it? We all do it. But if you notice that, maybe just coming back to presence, to yourself, to what the other person is sharing, to the rest of the group, and just trust that when it's your turn to share, there'll be plenty to say, so you don't have to rehearse anything or prepare anything in advance. And I'm just going to share my screen for a moment so we can have a sense of the props, and I'll also drop these in the chat. So these are new groups. So again, we'll be introducing ourselves to possibly folks we don't know. So yeah, just starting with our names and our pronouns again. What are the conditions that support safety in groups, and how do these conditions support? How do these conditions support what you're hoping to get from the retreat? Yeah. So those are the prompts. And we're gonna have 25 minutes for groups. So there's plenty of time in groups of five. You'll each have about 5 minutes to share. And our wonderful tech team will set a timer for you. So you'll have a sense of the time, and also maybe you could each take responsibility for just noticing the time and letting folks know if they're going over their time. And we're going to send you some reminders as well. So we'll send you a halfway reminder and a 5 minutes before the end reminder. And then also when that clock finishes, we have an extra minute. So there's that buffer period. So maybe you could just like work together as a group to try and wind things down in that minute. So no one gets cut off when we kind of get bounced back into the main room. And again, if you would rather not be in a group, if you could let the team know so they can make sure to keep you out of a group and you can just stay in the main room with the quiet music playing. Okay, so just bear with me while I grab those prompts and drop them in the chat for you. And I just want to check with our team how we're doing with getting groups set up. Are we pretty much ready to go?
Yeah, all good.
Great. So I've just dropped the prompts in the chat. It is 32 minutes past the hour, so we'll come back from groups at 57 minutes past the hour. I'm terrible at math. I think that's right. So enjoy each other, and we'll see you in a while. Okay, welcome back, everybody. Oh, nice to see you again for that brief moment of gallery view. So we've just got a minute here to wrap things up before we close for our longer break. I hope that there was enough time there for you all to share a bit around the conditions that support feeling of safety and connection in groups and how that can support you on this retreat. And we're gonna have some time in the first bit of the last session of the day to harvest from that discussion. And one way that we can not lose any of the gems or the fruits of your discussion is to invite you to share them in the chat. Or if you're feeling super tech savvy, we could also share them in the Padlet. So I'm just gonna actually share my screen and do a little demo of how the Padlet works to get you all excited about it. I'm excited about it. So let's just bear with me while I find that window. So here's the Padlet. And our community agreements are here, and it's a Google Doc. I won't click on it right now because I don't want to lose this page. But if you click on it, once you open the link to Padlet and you click on that, it should open a new window with that Google Doc. And then Viveka's gone ahead and put the prompts underneath. And I'm going to add a comment. I'm going to say that one thing that supports me, one condition that really helps me to feel a sense of safety and belonging is when everyone practices non-judging. It's nice to feel like you're not being judged. There's just a freedom to be exactly who you are, as you are. So you could drop your anything that you feel is important to share with the group, either in the chat or in the Padlet. And we will harvest those and then come back as a whole community. And in the first part of the next session, just name those things and then draw out any others or make any changes or additions that we want to make to the community agreements. So thank you so much for your full participation in our first session of this retreat, and we look forward to seeing you in about an hour and a half, and hope you enjoy whatever you're up to in this break. And feel free to unmute yourselves or make any reactions to say goodbye.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
See you later. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Bye.